President, my question is to the Minister for Workplace Safety. In September 2020, the Victorian WorkCover Authority was requested by Self-Employed Australia, pursuant to Section 131 of the Occupational Health and Safety Act, to investigate failures in the Victorian Government Hotel Quarantine Program. What briefings have you received about that request?
Your question. As I've indicated a number of times... I'm allowed to take that off. Sorry. As I've indicated a number of times in the Chamber to similar questions over a number of months now, matters relating to hotel quarantine are the responsibility for the Minister for Police. The member also knows that decisions regarding WorkSafe enforcement and compliance are at arm's length from me and my office. I am not briefed on any of the details of the investigations that are currently underway. I'm obviously aware that there are some investigations on foot. I know that through information provided to the Public Accounts and Estimates Committee and through media reports, but I'm not briefed on the details of those investigations. That would be inappropriate. Those investigations are at arm's length from me and my office.
Well, thank you, Mr. President. I thank the Minister for her response. The Minister in her answer said she is not briefed on any details of the investigation underway, and she also said that would be inappropriate. Yet, Section 131 subsection 2B of the Occupational Health and Safety Act requires the Victorian WorkCover Authority to report to the Minister every 3 months on an investigation when it extends beyond 3 months. This investigation has been ongoing for more than 9 months, so the Minister, if her department is following the Act, should have received at least two briefings on it. So the Minister has now either misled the House or the VWA is breaching the Act. Which is it?
Mr. Seed.
Thank you for your supplementary question, and I can assure you that I'm not misleading the House. Periodically, under the Act, WorkSafe is required to advise of any investigations under Section 131 of the Act. That is literally a list of investigations on foot with no details provided, and I have never sought any briefings of any of the details of any of those investigations because it would be completely inappropriate for me to do so.
Thank you. Mr. Quilty.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Premier. You've announced that you'll use COVID restrictions to coerce people into getting vaccine passports. You've dressed it up as a reward for being vaccinated, but freedom is a right, not a reward. It's more accurate to say you intend on punishing the unvaccinated until they get the jab. This is morally wrong. You're creating a new apartheid system where the unvaccinated are excluded from everyday life. But coercing the unvaccinated isn't just unethical, it's illogical. We know these vaccines won't produce a herd immunity, even with a vast majority at double jab status. The Delta variant COVID is still highly infectious, even amongst vaccinated Australians. Because of this, a vaccine only helps the person who gets it. Unvaccinated people only harm themselves. We should not lock down everyone to protect those who choose not to protect themselves. Premier, why are we waiting for 80% of Victorians to get double jabbed instead of just setting a date to open up?
Leader of the Government.
Thank you, President. I answered a very similar question to the Lib Dems yesterday in the form of the question from Mr. Limbrick. I thank Mr. Quilty for his question and his ongoing interest in all matters related to people's rights as they exist in Victoria and also people's health. Mr. Quilty, it is a fact that we are encouraging people to be vaccinated. What we are seeing around the world is that those that are unvaccinated, as you pointed out, are the ones that are likely to get the most sick, be in hospital and die. I take issue with elements of your question about the fact that those people that can't be vaccinated, that choose not to be vaccinated, can take the issue into their own hands. There are people with medical conditions that mean they can't be vaccinated, and as a mother of a 9-year-old and a 10-year-old who can't be vaccinated, it is my hope that most people who are able to be vaccinated take that opportunity at the first, take up that opportunity as soon as possible to protect themselves, their communities, their families, and indeed enable the state to get back to something close to normal.
Mr. Quilty, on a supplementary.
We need a clear end to this endless COVID lockdown nightmare. Enough is enough. 2 weeks to flatten the curve became 6 months to find a vaccine, became 2 years of authoritarians taking away our rights and letting us forget how to live free. We have a vaccine. We finally have millions of doses rolling into the country. Anyone who wants to protect themselves will now have the option to do so. The time has come to put this behind us. Set a date to end the lockdowns. By December 4th, everyone who is concerned about COVID will have had a chance to get a vaccine. Those who refuse to get vaccines have made their choice, and we should respect that, and they bear the consequences of their choice. Free people don't need to show their vaccine passports to go about their business. At the start of this pandemic, my colleague David Limbrick asked if Victorians would ever get their freedoms back. You told us they would. Premier, will you commit to making December 4th a day of freedom in Victoria by ending all COVID restrictions on or before that day?
Leader of the government.
Thank you, President. I'll take most of that as a statement as opposed to a question. Mr. Quilty, there's a national cabinet arrangement where the premiers and leaders and prime minister of our country are working on ensuring that there is the opportunity for states to contribute to a plan to ensure that all of Australia can enjoy being able to be free of restrictions that have been put in place to protect the health, and they're all committed to that work. Most governments are committed to this work. We want to be able to open up. That's the whole very reason that we are trying to suppress the virus and encourage people to be vaccinated, and we'll continue in those efforts.
Minister's statement, Minister's seat.
Thank you, President. I rise to update the House about the Andrews Labor government's actions to keep young workers safe at work. WorkSafe's Victoria Unsafe is Always Unacceptable campaign has been running on digital and social platforms recently, urging young workers to keep safe on the job. The campaign features young workers being asked questions about their willingness to ignore health and safety concerns if it means they can secure a job. Out of the 23 young workers featured in the campaign, 21 said they would work without training, accept bullying and harassment as part of the job, and accept unsafe working conditions to secure employment. WorkSafe's campaign highlights that young workers can often have a poor understanding of health and safety risks and can feel intimidated to speak up. It's a priority of this government to make sure every workplace is safe and to ensure that every worker knows what their rights are. So far this year, WorkSafe has accepted more than 750 claims for workers aged between 15 and 24, in addition to the 2,390 claims that were accepted in 2020. 19% of these claims were from workers in construction and 17% from workers in manufacturing, making these industries the most hazardous for young workers. The campaign is a timely reminder that even while our focus may be on the global pandemic, there is no excuses for failing to protect young workers. All employers have a responsibility to ensure every worker is safe, no matter their age or their understanding of the health and safety information. For young workers, this includes being empowered to speak up if they have concerns and are unsure about how to complete a task safely. I urge young workers to visit the WorkSafe website to learn more about the importance of safety at work.
Thank you. Mr. Grimley.
Thanks, President. So my question is for the Minister for Higher Education, for the attention of the Minister for Corrections. In the view of my party, if an offender is sentenced, they should be accountable to that sentence. It underpins the integrity of our legal system that conditions of CCOs, such as curfews, exclusion orders, treatment and rehabilitation orders, are enforced properly, otherwise offenders, without doubt, see this as a loophole that they can exploit. I've been informed that during COVID, community corrections services are not checking in on offenders who have specific conditions attached to their CCOs. If true, this is extremely worrying. Further, with this new strategy of no longer seeking eradication of COVID, we will inevitably see cases climb and risk increase. This worries our party as it's difficult to strike the balance of offender accountability and safety for corrections officers. We've had over 13,000 people on a CCO last year, so it's more offenders than in our whole prison system. It's a big issue. Minister, how is our justice system in current COVID lockdowns and restrictions checking in on offenders who have conditions, especially those on CCOs?
Minister Tini.
Thank you, President. I thank the member for the question. This is an important issue that the member has raised. There are certain allegations in the question, and I'm sure that the Minister for Corrections will be providing an answer to you consistent with the standing orders.
Thank you. Mr. Grimley on a supplementary.
Thanks, President. Thank you, Minister. The Andrews government recently announced that it will follow the WA model and the current South Australian trial of home quarantine. Both states are using technology that requires the person to submit a photo of their face and their geolocation, proving they are where they are supposed to be and that they haven't just left their phone with someone else. Whilst we don't have a position on home quarantine, my party would like to see this technology rolled out across community corrections to check in with offenders who have curfew conditions and exclusion orders. I should note here that every offender who goes to drug court has a curfew condition, and I've been told by those working in the drug court that rarely are curfews monitored, but often they are breached. Not only would this be great for ensuring compliance, but would also be good for offenders who do comply to be acknowledged for their good behaviour. Currently, it's all speculative. My supplementary question, therefore, is, Minister, is the government exploring using technology for offenders to ensure they are complying with their CCOs, and if not, why not?
Supplementary question. I do know that Corrections already uses a number of forms of different technologies in terms of ensuring that CCOs are complied with, but I think that this is a new form of technology that you are requesting, and the Minister will address that in her answer to you. Thank you.
Mr. Rich Phillips.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. President, my question is again to the Minister for Workplace Safety. Following the failure of the Victorian Workcover Authority to complete its investigation that was requested by Self-Employed Australia, a request was made pursuant to Section 131, Subsection 3 of the Occupational Health and Safety Act to refer the matter to the Director of Public Prosecutions. In a letter of the 4th of August, Kerry Judd QC, the Director of the DPP, wrote, "The matter remains under investigation by WorkSafe Victoria. I cannot make a determination on this matter until I have viewed the investigative materials." Why has the VWA failed to provide the investigatory documents to the DPP as required by the OH&S Act?
Minister Stitt.
Thank you, President. And as I've already indicated in my previous answer, I do not involve myself in investigations that are on foot by the safety regulator. That would be entirely inappropriate. There are provisions under Section 131 of the Act, as you have outlined, which require WorkSafe to meet certain reporting obligations during the course of an investigation if it goes on for a period of time. But I am not aware of the letter. I'm not aware of the contents of the letter from the person that you mentioned. All that I am aware of is that there are a number of investigations on foot that relate to hotel quarantine. I'm not briefed on the details of those investigations, and nor would I seek to be so, because that would be inappropriate. It's very important, and a principle that I think ought to be upheld, that the safety regulator conducts its investigations free from any political interference from any government member or MP.
Thank you. Mr. Rich Phillip on a supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. President. I thank the Minister for her response. Mr. President, no one is asking the Minister to intervene in investigation. But the letter that I quoted is not a letter from Joe Smith. It's a letter from Kerry Judd QC, the Director of Public Prosecutions, who is entitled to receive the documents in relation to this investigation under the OH&S Act. Minister, as the responsible Minister, it is your role to ensure that the Victorian Workcover Authority complies with the OH&S Act. What action are you taking as Minister to ensure it does that?
I've already answered the question on a number of occasions, and the answer remains that investigations are at arm's length from my office, and that is entirely appropriate.
Minister's statement. Order. Mr. Davis on a point of order.
Point of order. You know, the Minister has the responsibility for this Act under the administrative orders. No, my point of order is, if the Minister won't answer this question, which Minister should we direct it to?
Thank you, members. Thank you. No point of order. Mr. Statement, Ms. Pulford.
Thank you, President. I'm very excited to give the House an update about some recent announcements and the community engagement underway as part of our Connecting Victoria program. We're fast-tracking mobile and broadband connectivity improvements across the state through the record $550 million Connecting Victoria program. And I was delighted to announce recently the first 12 of 120 broadband upgrades that will be fast-tracking across Victoria. Up to 10,000 businesses in Pakenham North, Pakenham South, Cranbourne South, Dramana, Lara, Colac, Hamilton, Portland, Wonthaggi, Inverloch, Warragul and Benalla will be the first to benefit. The Andrews Labor Government is investing $73 million and partnering with NBN Co to make this infrastructure for improved fibre connections available free of charge. Businesses will only need to pay an ongoing fee to connect to the service should they wish to do so. Businesses will have access to faster and more reliable fibre internet, making it easier for them to handle large files, to video conference and to capture real-time data. We want to make sure Victoria is the most connected state, helping people stay connected to one another, their communities and services, and the information they need via the digital world has never been more important. Further engagement is underway on the next areas to benefit from this significant investment. We've just completed 9 engagement roundtables with our regional partnerships in their areas, and this week we begin our roundtables with interface councils to discuss connectivity initiatives for outer suburban growth areas across Melbourne. We're also giving every Victorian the opportunity to have their say about how we could play a role in delivering better mobile coverage and broadband to areas across the state. I encourage members and everyone else to have their say at the Engage Victoria website, Connecting Victoria. Very pleased that we've had nearly 4,000 Victorians log on and share their views. This past 18 months has shown us all how important being able to connect to the digital world is, and this significant $550 million investment will open up even greater access for many businesses and residents, making us all more connected.
Ms. Batten.
Thank you, President. And my question is to the Minister for Small Business. The UK has invested in pathogen reduction ventilation, and a team of engineers, scientists, and medical experts have developed a system that uses high-intensity UVC light to kill airborne pathogens. It removes 99.99% of COVID. And the technology is being trialled right now in the legendary Soho 100 Club. I'm aware the Victorian Government has set up a task force to improve ventilation in healthcare settings, but my question is, has the department conducted any research or sought to fund pathogen reduction technology to assist Victorian small businesses and improve ventilation, particularly in live music venues, bars and everything that makes Melbourne, Melbourne?
Minister Pulford.
Thank you, President. I thank Ms. Patton for her question. It was a trial in the UK that I was not aware of, but it sounds important and interesting. Certainly, I can confirm that the government is undertaking work on ventilation and the important role that that plays. And I'd sort of note the significant work of people at the Burnet Institute in helping us all better understand the importance of ventilation now that it is well established that COVID-19 is indeed airborne, something that this time last year was still a subject of some conjecture around the world. In terms of ventilation support trials and new technology for small businesses, the short answer is no, not specifically, but the broader, more general answer is yes, we engage with our small business community and our small business community's leaders and organisations, peak bodies, all the time on all manner of issues, and I'm certainly aware of the interest and desire to explore and understand opportunities around ventilation. our small business community cannot get through the national roadmap steps and milestones fast enough. And so, you know, I have lots of offers from people wanting to be part of trials and pilots, lots of ideas and suggestions about incentivising vaccinations, because our small business community has borne a very, very heavy share of the burden that the community has experienced these last 18 months, and they understand the quickest path to their recovery and getting back to doing what they love and what they're so great at is, of course, that plan, that roadmap, high rates of vaccination, and of course all other measures that can assist us to live with COVID as it becomes endemic. So I hope that's satisfied your interest in this, Ms. Patton, and yeah, I look forward to seeing how the trial goes.
Ms. Patton, on a supplementary.
Thank you, President, and thank you, Minister. And certainly we know that the live music venues in particular have borne a significant brunt, and it you know, reopening at 24%, you know, all of these things just don't work, particularly for those live music venues. You know, they've been sort of locked out of some of the funding because they don't have kitchens, they don't fit into all of the models of support. But the UK is kind of taking this test, clean, prevent model, particularly for their entertainment, hospitality, and nighttime economy. So, by way of supplementary, I would ask, would you speak to the US counterparts and see what they are doing, particularly for that live music, those small businesses in the live music industry?
Minister Pulford.
Thank you. Like many Victorians, I desperately miss being able to go to live music venues, and if there are things that we can explore with the live music industry to help them operate better, more fully, more completely in a COVID-safe environment, then absolutely, I'd be very happy to learn some more about this. I take the opportunity to commend so many in the Australian live music industry, promoters, supporters, for the launch of their vaccination campaign a couple of days ago. It's incumbent upon all of us, I think, that have any sort of audience at all to spread the word. I know that the question from our Lib Dems colleague just a moment ago sort of suggested that, you know, the balance of rights and responsibilities from their perspective is a little different to the way that the rest of us see it. I think that most in the live music industry would care very much for the rights of them to trade, the rights of them to perform, and the rights of their patrons to be safe.
Ms. Barth.
Thank you, President. President, my question is to the Minister for Emergency Services. The East Gippsland timber training coop used to instruct emergency service personnel, including DELP, Summer Firefighters, SES, CFA and VicPol, on how to identify and safely fell dangerous trees, has been shut down due to an injunction. Minister, how can the government guarantee the safety of these 270 first responders, given that they will no longer be able to be trained in time for the upcoming fire season?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and I thank Ms. Barth for her question, and I'll have to get some further advice in relation to the injunction on the area that you are identifying. But rest assured, what I know from not only the 2 weeks I've had this portfolio, but the time that I've been an MP and dealt with emergency services, is that they take the health and safety of their volunteers and staff extremely important. The highest esteem that they do in protecting Victorians every day. So rest assured that training, health and wellbeing, and ensuring that people are well prepared, particularly for the upcoming fire season, will be front of mind. In relation to whether there are arrangements to find other venues or things have been put at alternative places in the area, then you probably know more than me about that right now, Ms. Barth, but I'm happy to go and take that on notice, given it's a very specific local issue that you've raised.
Ms. Barth, on a supplementary.
Thank you, President, and I thank the Minister for her response. My interest lies in what action the government will take to stop further injunctions which are putting these frontline first responders at risk because they are unable to actually get into these training coops and have proper training?
Bath, I don't see how that would be a question that would be correctly directed to the Minister for Emergency Services remotely. How does the Emergency Services Minister get involved in a matter like that? I'll take it on notice, but it won't be the right minister because I've got no role in this portfolio of getting involved in legal actions that involve injunctions.
Minister's statement, Minister Tini.
Thank you, President. I'm pleased to rise and update the Chamber on the fantastic success of free TAFE in getting Victorians into jobs and giving more Victorians access to training. Labor is the party of TAFE. We are the party that invests in TAFE, a government that invests very strongly in TAFE, providing the best training in the best facilities with the best teachers. And free TAFE is such an important part of this. Now in its second year, free TAFE continues to change lives. I want to share with the Chamber some of the important outcomes of free TAFE. There were more than 70,000 enrolments in free TAFE courses in 2020, building on nearly 40,000 commencements in 2019. That means more women in free TAFE courses, more learners with a disability, more culturally and linguistically diverse students, and more unemployed Victorians looking to find new work. One of the proudest achievements of free TAFE in 2020 has been adding the Certificate 3 and the Diploma of Early Childhood Education to the free TAFE list. The outcomes speak for themselves with the doubling of enrolments in these courses. This is exactly what we need to fill the pipeline of workers needed to roll out three-year-old kindergarten. Some of the most important courses in 2020 were nursing, community services, building and construction, disability and cybersecurity. Courses that are aligned to where the jobs are, President. Importantly, students have saved $150 million in course fees since free TAFE started. That means more Victorians being able to access TAFE because of the cost barrier isn't there. Free TAFE changes lives, gives Victorians pathways to meaningful careers, and that's why we back it, President.
Thank you, Dr. Cumming.
Thank you, Mr. President. And my question is to the Minister for Health in the other place. Who determines who are essential workers? I, like many others, really want the answer to this question. We want to know if it is the Chief Health Officer, or the Cabinet, or the Premier, or whoever. Following the inquiry into the hotel quarantine program and the notion of creeping assumptions come into play, that is, that no single person, department or agency made the decision, but the decision was made on default on a series of creeping assumptions, I, like many others, would like to see the working behind these decisions. Let's hope the Minister can answer this simple question.
Thank you, President. Dr. Cummings, the determination of essential workers in relation to the restrictions and the health orders involve a collaboration of ministers and departments. As you'd appreciate, the Department of Jobs, Precincts and Regions obviously has a big role to play. The Minister Pakula has the role for industry engagement. There have been, for the past 18 months, regular roundtables. There's been some adjustments to those lists. For example, when I was in the agricultural portfolio, we spent a lot of time working around what was essential for farmers, for example. It didn't just extend to people that were driving tractors, but obviously people that were selling fertiliser and the like. So the lists have evolved and are based on industry feedback, stakeholder engagement, and obviously then go to health in relation to what can be approved and what can't. But as I think the experience has indicated, that we have been able to react and adapt where certain cases have come up. For instance, ultimately it's a decision for health, but all of those, all the information that goes into health to make those decisions come from a range of areas of the department, industry and stakeholders.
Coming on a supplementary.
Thank you, Attorney, and I look forward to the Minister's response. What are the criteria to be classified as an essential worker or an essential provider? Now, the DHHS website provides a list of those classed as essential. Since we have been put into our first lockdown, I've spoken about the inconsistencies. And while I'm grateful that the changes have been made over time, there are still some inconsistencies. For example, bottle shops are essential, but tobacconists aren't. Now, so hopefully providing the criteria will provide some more clarity. The community would like to see the science and the health advice attached to such decisions, such as Westgate Tunnel workers are deemed essential, but small business owners are not considered essential.
President, I'm pretty sure I covered off the topics that Dr. Cumming raised in her supplementary question in my answer to the substantive, just to reiterate that there is a range of information that goes into determining what workers are permitted to be active during restrictions, and various settings have resulted in different decisions for different groups. For example, we know that it's safer for outdoor workers, for example, so if you could demonstrate that your workplace was outdoors, then that was something that could be authorised. I know for gyms, for instance, could run outdoor classes, not indoor classes. So effectively, it's around consultation with industry stakeholders and relevant ministers who seek advice from health about what can be permitted, and those conversations are always ongoing.
Mr. Davis.
You are, Mr. President. Mr. President, my question is to the Minister for Emergency Services. Minister, I refer you to the revelations reported earlier this week that courageous whistleblower FRV female firefighter Commander Donna Wheatley is now calling out alleged serious systemic sexual harassment and assault at work over an abusive period of 20 years within the MFB and FRV. Commander Wheatley is one of many alleged victims of a toxic workplace culture of sexual harassment, intimidation and bullying that was the very basis of the 2016 Verioc report that was blocked from public release. These issues are obviously not alien to the Labor Party with the attacks on then Minister Ms. Garrett. Minister, will you now, as the new Minister, now demand the release of the Verioc report so that the unacceptable toxic workplace culture of sexual harassment, intimidation and bullying within our fire services is finally exposed?
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. O'Donoghue for his question. And Mr. O'Donoghue, the fact that I am now proudly the new Minister for Emergency Services doesn't change the status of a report that is subject to court orders. As I have explained in this chamber before, as the Leader of the Government, the Chamber asked me to produce a copy of the report. We undertook a search within government. We do not have a copy of the report. I wrote to Verioc and explained that the Council's motion and received a response from them that they could not provide me with a copy of the report. There's nothing in my new role that would give me any more powers in relation to that. But I would say these are important matters. I welcome people talking about workplace culture, workplace harassment. It has no place in any workplace, and certainly not in our emergency services. Despite a five-year-old report being public or not, that doesn't change my commitment to be working with our emergency services to ensure that we have fantastic workplaces for women and for anybody who wants to work in those workplaces. And we've got commitment from these services to improve their culture. It's one of their highest priorities, to make improvements that complement their management processes and their information and their complaints processes. And indeed, it is something, obviously, I'm concerned about. Reports in the paper certainly draw public attention to that, and I certainly give my full commitment to stamping out these these cultural issues within the workforces, and I'm pleased that I've received advice from all of the emergency services agencies that they are focused on these topics, and it's certainly on the agendas of every meeting that I have with them.
Mr. Rodoni on a supplementary.
Thank you, President. I thank the Minister for her response, and noting your refusal to do anything further in relation to the 2016 report, you've then enunciated a number of, you know, well-intentioned words. I suppose, Minister, these allegations are not new, and it takes an enormous amount of courage, as I'm sure we all recognise, for someone to speak out in the way that the Commander has, and it probably comes at some significant cost to that individual. So, Minister, over and above the words you've just expressed, what will you actually do? What will you actually do to get to the bottom of these allegations, these issues that have been within our fire services now for years and years and years? What action will you actually take to address these horrific, terrible, shocking revelations now that you are the Minister for Emergency Services?
Minister.
Thank you, President. At the outset, I welcome people making public their experiences in their workplaces of sexual harassment, but given this matter is a matter that is subject to internal investigation and potential court proceedings, I would certainly not want to make comment in relation to specific individuals and their allegations, although I would put on the record that anybody that does make these allegations, I do thank them for being brave and bringing these to the forefront. Mr. O'Donoghue, you threw a lot of words around then, accusing me of throwing around words, but I guess I can just confirm that as the new Minister for Emergency Services, I want to tackle this issue. I want to call it out. I want to work with the agencies. I want to understand their practices, how they deal with complaints, how they deal with victims, and how they are dealing with their education and training of potentially dealing with the systemic issues.
Thank you.